we are. Yeah, I like at the start. It's a short presentation anyway, so it's no problem if we start a little bit later. We start with presenting myself. I am Luis Gomez. I work for Brocade, but I spend most of my time in Open Daylight in two projects. I'm the project technical lead for the integration group, as well as I'm committer for the. Oh, sorry. Is okay? Up. Up, up, up. Okay. Is it better now?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. That's why. Cool. So yeah, again, I'm I spend most of my time. I'm Luis Gomez, and I spend all of, most of my time in the integration project and also in the Relem Builder group of project in Open Daylight. There, I'm a committer, but we have the project technical lead as well there. Hey. So what is all this about? I mean, one of the things I want to clarify is that initially this was a presentation for test strategy, so there is still some of the displays. It said this is test strategy, but at some point of time I thought it was really more interesting, especially for this kind of conference with more people and people that are not Open Daylight, to emphasize or at least explain what was the achievements, not just for testing, that there were a few, but for the continuous integration in general, and especially in infrastructure for the continuous integration. So that's why I revealed this, and also I changed the name and put high performance. There is some test content here, but it's all not only tests, it's also continuous integration and build system. So that's why. So, yeah, this is the phrase that I heard a few times. I didn't know who actually said that in the beginning, so I had to do my searching. And I could not agree more on this phrase after working in Open Daylight for a while. I mean, of course what you do is important. We are creating a very good product here made of community and people and collaboration, open platform, blah, blah. But it's also how you do it. And I can tell that in some situations, especially this one, how you do it is even more important. Because the product, as you can understand, the trends change very quickly. And if you don't have a system behind an infrastructure, you don't have something that how you do things is the right thing, you're going to have problems. So that's why I think it's also, this phrase is really, really telling me that, even if people, like you can see, there are not so many people here, most of the people, they something that they don't care much. It's probably the most important thing, in my opinion, that we are doing in Open Daylight today. All the infrastructure, all the backstage, and all the things that we are doing for the projects, for the people to write their code and to test and to do all the things that they need to do as an open source project. Okay? You can interrupt me any. We have a few people here, so if you have any question anytime, just raise your hand. And then I will answer the question. So we don't need to go through the end and everything. So, and also it's a short presentation. So what is continuous integration and why it matters? We hear these words every time, continuous integration, CI, what is this? Well, it's nothing really complicated. And this is probably the definition that I found more clear for continuous integration. Continuous integration, it's a development practice that requires developer to integrate code into a shared repository, so there is always a repository there several times a day, so kind of often. We want developers to kind of push code often. Each check-in is then verified by an automatic build and test, and then this is for sure to get immediate or very quick understanding if there is an issue, there is a problem in the code. So there is a lot of benefits actually of the continuous integration is this circle that you see there. And the main benefit is that you should detect problems very early. And this is very obvious for anybody. The later you detect a problem in the chain of development, the more problems you have. Like if you depend in early development, it's more or less feasible, easy to fix and quick. If you just identify the problem before you release, still you need to involve some people and fix it. If you identify the issue after the release, you have to put more effort to patch, make a hot fix, and then patch the thing. And if you find issues in the field, somebody else, and everything is even more complicated. So it's clear for sure that the sooner you get detect a problem, the better you can tackle it and you can fix it, and that's very optimal. So that's why this continuous integration, in my opinion, works. Now, how does it look like in open daylight? The image that I saw before, simple thing. Well, in open daylight is not that simple, but still, still is the same concept, and there is not much change, as you can see. I mean, it's exactly the same. We have contributors, which is developers normally. They push code into the SCM, the code management system, and this produces an event that goes to our build system, which is managed by Jenkins. This produces a build. The build, of course, pulls some artifacts from our repositories. Once the build succeed, there is a code verified tick. It could be verified or not verified, but normally if it is verified, this goes to Gerrit and say, okay, this passed the build. After that, we have committers, which are the people in OpenDLI who have some rights into the project to approve or deny the code. And they just, if they don't agree with the code, they first need to write down, I mean, in the FCM, in the patch tool, they need to write down why they don't agree, so that the contributor can file a new patch. If they agree with the code, they merge the code, and that generates a new event in the system that goes to the Jenkins builder and then produce another build of the code. Exactly the same as before, I need to download artifacts, but now because I merge, so supposedly the code is okay, I can actually upload artifacts. And that is happening only when I merge, that I upload the build artifact to Nexus, the same repository that before. Now, the part that is also very new and very, not new, well, or new, I don't know. This part is really, because when you see all the build system, it's supposed you do test and build at the same time and then you produce a result, and that is the continuous integration for most of the people. But what we are doing in OpenDLI, we don't stop there, and we do one more step. Yes?
When you mean code verified, you mean it is tested by the contributor before?
No, this verification is done automatically in Jenkins. So what's happening is that there is a build of the code with all the unit tests that is already there. And that will give you an idea, two ideas. That will give you an idea that the code doesn't break the build, so all your dependencies and everything are fine. And the second thing is because you have JUnit, at least your bundle or your unit is fine at that level. So that is all about the build test. The second build test, why you need to build two times? That's also a classic question. Well, the first time you build is to verify that the first time you push something in the system is okay, so you need to have a build to verify. The second time is because while people are reviewing your code, it could be people also pushing code and also reviewing code and approving code. So in the end, we want to verify that after merge, there is no conflict still or any problem in building your code and testing your code with the other patches that were in between. So that's why. So the part that is really new in OpenDLI, and I think, well, no, in OpenDLI is not new, but I think it's new for new people, is we don't stop in the project build itself, in the build test. Every time there is a merge in the system, we actually build a distribution, a full distribution of OpenDLI with all the features, with everything that has a distribution today. And to do that, I need to download artifacts because the distribution is made of many projects. After I do that, actually, am I loading the distribution to Nexus? This is a step that in the beginning was planned to do when I test everything I upload. But because we want to get this distribution available, even if there is an issue to test this, today the process is we download artifacts and then upload anyway. When we get the distribution done, we upload. But at the same time, we launch what we call the system test. And this is the part that is very interesting, because the system test, what it's going to do is to automatically set up a test environment where you have your distribution running in a VM, and then you have like two or three more VMs, or more if you want, to do whatever system test you want to do. And system test understood like a black box test, like you deploy your controller, and then you can have, you know, tools like OBS, Mininet, whatever virtual tool, of course, it's not hardware.
Something I don't understand. The project build is only your module, testing your module alone, or testing it with your whole distribution?
Okay, that's a cool thing. So the project build is only your project. So in OpenDaylight, we have projects like contributions, and they have their own, you know, repository. So whenever we said do a project build, we take the repository, their Git, and then we just build it. This is what it is.
So until the second build, I didn't test actually OpenDaylight, only
your contribution, yes. Okay. Only your contribution. So that's why we need this, the last part is needed.
Yes.
The only thing is in continuous integration, maybe you don't spend time building the full distribution and testing all together. But we are doing that here, actually. So we are building the full thing and we are doing system tests for every merge that is happening very often.
What if your project needs dependencies from other projects and they are building, you want to test your project, but other projects were modified in the...
So what happens is every time you build in the system, you pull all the dependencies. All the download artifacts that I said there is all the dependencies of the other people that you need for building. And in the last case, the download artifact is it downloads all the projects because I need all the projects to build the distribution. I get all the artifacts, all the binaries, all the jars from all the projects. Okay? More. Is there, sorry?
The very last download artifacts.
Yes. Oh yes. Yeah. So the way this works is the way Jenkins work today is that a particular distribution build. Well, there are different questions here that you mentioned. Before you used to have a unique distribution job in the past, and for sure you have a job until you finish. You don't start the next one, so there is no problem on that. Today we have several distribution jobs. Every project has its own distribution. So this question came before. Like what happened if I have two projects and they're building in parallel and they are testing in parallel? And then what happened if I'm unloading artifacts at the same time that I'm downloading? So for that, I think Andy has the the answer. There is Nessus use timestamp, I think, as the millisecond, kind of millisecond precision. So it's very unlike that you're gonna overlap something. I mean, when you start your downloading, you take one of these snapshots, I mean, one of these timestamp, and you use this timestamp all the time. So it's very unlikely that you're gonna create a conflict because this millisecond kind of precision timestamp. I think it's something like that, no? But very good question anyway, because we got that before in the community. Yeah, and there is an explanation as well, now we are in family here, why we went from one distribution job to many distribution jobs. We could eventually come back to the only one distribution job. It's a possibility. What happened is one of the strategies that I'm going to explain later is depending on which project I'm building, I'm interested to run this or that series of tests. And the way we have today, because we don't have a management tool for Jenkins tell, okay, after this job, run this job, we need to do everything in triggers. The way to do this in triggers, like separate one test for this build, another test for this build, is to say, okay, I have different distribution jobs that they trigger different tests. That's the way we do today. But this could change in future. I will comment that as well.
So how often do these step tests
fail? These are the questions that I like. Very good. So yeah, so in the beginning, when we were doing very little system tests, to be honest, was kind of very stable. And because there were very few people doing that, and also very few. Yeah, you wrote some tests and then you spend some time debugging to make it stable, and after that was super stable. So it was never failed. It will give you an immediate idea if something was wrong. Very easy, right? Nowadays, because we started to have a lot of people writing system tests, and also there is much more system tests than before, yeah, the system tests normally in globally fail. So for a project, they write a system test, and it's very difficult to come up with a system test that works all the way. And something that I realized this release, and we were commenting that before, is that by release time, when we say we're going to release or close to release, that all the tests should be stable. Like when I see, when I see a green is a green, and when I see a red is a red. I don't want to really see confusing stuff. And if I still see a red, it's because there is a bug. And if there is a bug that we are not going to fix because maybe a small thing, well, at least get the back number somewhere that everybody knows, okay, this is supposed to fail, no problem, right? So this kind of understanding we need to have. And the more system tests you put in the system and the more people write in the test, we're going to get this situation where we're going to see more reds in the system. Sometimes it's because people are debugging. Most of the time it's because people are debugging the system test code, so it's not fully stable. And some other times could be because there is a bug. There is a real bug and maybe it's not been fixed yet. And you have a test case precisely to identify the bug. Yeah. Any other question? Yes. Yes, I mean, this is what I call a full CI cycle that goes from a get read event, especially merge, we'll see later, and then finish with your system test. What we are missing today, and this is advancing a little bit my presentation, is that all the test is happening the way I'm presenting here. So when you do a merge in OVSDB project, it will trigger whatever test is in the downstream. I mean, in your case, maybe not too many, but if we see for, no, you have a few actually. But OpenFlow, for instance, has more, and Controller and JanTool has many. So every time there is some merge there, you trigger a lot of tests out of that. The problem we have today is that there is no connection. I mean, the upstream, you cannot see immediately all the project, that, all the tests that you have triggered, because the trigger happened from downstream to upstream. When that something happened in upstream, you trigger downstream tests. So the downstream project, yes, he knows whenever something fails, and he can go and check exactly which thing in the upstream make that project fail. But if I was in the upstream and I want to see the effect of my patch, it's very difficult today. But that is something I will comment, we're gonna fix that as well. In this release, hopefully. Ah, that's a very cool question. So system test today, and this was out of discussion here, system test today leaves, there are two things for system tests. One is the automation part of it, which is the Jenkins part of it. That lives in Relent Builder, as everybody has the automation there. So we have our Jenkins job has templates in the Relent Builder repo. The system test itself, which uses the Robot Framework, is in integration repository today. So we created folders there and people are pushing. The reason to do that, there is a good reason for this, because we were thinking to actually say, okay, if you are a project responsible for your system test, why don't you have the system test with you? And then you approve yourself and you do your own. Well, it seems easy, but it's not. And that could end up in a situation where people just do whatever they want and they don't follow any pattern. So in the end, we really wanted, at least in the beginning, to get all the system test integration. So we review, because we have been doing this before. We review them, we check them, we help people when they have questions. It's much more difficult to help them when they have in their repository, they are pushing into integration. And especially, there is a lot of value as well, because we, at least in integration, we have some kind of knowledge of what's going on, like what is the amount of system test that every project has in Open Daylight. So it's a way to centralize, but also has a little bit of control, so a little bit of alignment. I mean, you cannot really have a good strategy if you don't put a little bit of control. So you let people run tests for 1 hour, whatever, and they approve their own tests. You have tests there, it doesn't make sense in CI, right? So we are very careful when we are reviewing patches and everything to make sure that they do what they should do with some time limitation, because this is CI, you cannot run for hours. And all these kind of things we take care very well in integration, so that's why. More questions, yes. Ah, this is good.
So you brought the time issue.
So this is the good question as well. Today we don't have a system, and this is going to be later as well, to measure this time, but we will have. Now, I can estimate. I can estimate because what happened here is the project build, depending how much code, how big is your project. Controller projects today, I think, takes like 1 hour with all the tests that is there in the controller project. But if you go to a smaller project, maybe 10 minutes, between 5-10 minutes for a small project in OpenDaylight, you have your build done and verified, okay? The second is the distribution. This thing, kind of thing, distribution, it takes, I think today it's taken by between 10 and 15 minutes, no more than that, to build the entire distribution and pass some tests, because we are passing some build tests as well. So where are we spending most of the time? Probably in the system test. The system test, requires spin up some VMs that you're going to use for your system test. You're going to spend your time installing the controller, like calling it to start up with features. Especially you will see later when we bring all the features, that takes considerable time. If you just bring one feature, it's very easy, just take 1 minute. If you bring all the features that are today available in OpenDaylight, that takes some time. So most of the time that is today is in the system test. And that's why I will tell later, one of the things we have focused this release is exactly on system test, to make it as fast and performance as possible. Because we know, I mean, time-wise, the bottleneck is going to be there, for sure. More.
So are you running a system test instance for every check-in?
For every merge.
For every merge.
Merge. And I will tell that we could do for every check-in, but that's too costly. Because there are so many check-ins, and you don't know if these check-ins are valid or not.
Okay.
So we cannot do it. So still today is merge. It's only merge.
So then what's the correspondence between check-ins and merges?
So when you check something in the system, is the code submit, is the first step a developer does. In order to get a merge, a committer has to approve your code. Say, okay, this code is valid.
I know what the steps are, but is there a one-to-one correspondence between a submission that's going to be successful?
Okay, yeah, good point. I get you now. Most of the submission after some reviews get merged, yes. For your question, I get there is a one-to-one most of the time, but not always. Some people can drop as well, yeah, code.
Are you talking about the difference between patch notes and merges? Because the verified jobs are
Oh, is that?
I'm just trying to get a clearer picture related to his question of, if you can get sort of an estimate of how long it takes from check-in to system test, and if you do a system test instance
mm-hmm.
for every merge, then that gives you a clearer idea. If you had to aggregate some merges into groups for system test, then it's harder to estimate.
Yeah, that's also the point. The Jenkins system today actually does this. If you start to queue, you actually, after some time, if you are running this distribution, they are busy and so on, they're going to pile up the garrets, I mean the merges. So in a normal situation, if there is no congestion, what I have seen in the system is that you have a single patch merge per system test. But in a situation where we have many people pushing code, and especially not pushing code, but merging, when you have people merging very often and there is some congestion in the system, what Jenkins does automatically, because I have seen that tracing back, is that he can put some merge together, and then I only build a distribution made of these 2-3 patches instead of only one. So that exists today. And it is in an uncontrolled way. I think this is totally default way that Jenkins does when this situation happens. We want to get more control on that. And this is one of the things that we need later, a tool that is going to fully control what's going on. We want to really control what happens when you have congestions. And today, this is the default behavior, and I don't know how to change that. That's the truth. And it's not bad. I mean, you have a lot of distribution piling. In the end, it's going to compress these garrets and then create a distribution for 3 or 4 of them. Of course, by doing that, what's happening is that if there is an issue, now you need to see 3-4 different places where the issue comes from. But still works.
In design, if there's a distribution built on a system test set that fails, there was a set of merged garrets, rerun system tests for each one of those patches.
So, sorry, say again?
If you have congestion and Jenkins starts a distribution build on system test for, say, 4 garret patches merged together,
yes.
And that fails, you could then
I mean, it's always, I will say later, you could start on-demand testing as well. This is all automatic. What happened is this is all automatic, and the distribution is done by this kind of trigger. It's very unlike, to be honest with you, I have never seen, unless there is a failure in the infrastructure, I have never seen that a distribution build fails because there is very little to do there. You just take the components that are already built, and you put them together. So that step fails very, very little. And when it fails, it's because there is some dependency issue that has once introduced. When you get a distribution fail, the system test doesn't even start. I mean, there is no point to do any system test if you cannot even build the distribution. But for your question, there is different ways to do this. You can start your test manually, but there is also in Garrett, there is some keyboard that you can use. And you can remerge your job. If you want to re-verify your job, you can re-verify and you can remerge. Re-verify in this case will just build, but it will not pass system tests. But if you do a remerge, like this command in Gerrit, this kind of keyword, it will build and also produce a new system test for it. So yeah, it's possible. And user can do that as well. It's not often, but they can do. Yes. Yeah.
Right? So like open flow, we have their own system test. So when I check something and I say check something in AAA and it gets all the way through here to the end to run system test, does it run only AAA system test?
Yeah, that's a good question and I'm gonna explain that after. But the thing is, yes, this is simplified that said, okay, after your distribution in that you run some system tests. Now your question, what kind of system test I'm running here? My own? Anybody else? Because I am in the upstream, so I need to verify it downstream. So that is coming later and the question is yes. Depending on your project, you're going to get this or less or more amount of system tests run.
Okay, but not all.
All is only in a couple of situations. One is when you generate a release candidate, we want to get all tested, whatever is available. Mm-hmm. And there is another situation that you will see later is when I want to verify a patch. If someone wants to say, especially the upstream project, I want to verify a patch doesn't break, you know,
yeah.
In general. It's very uncommon that this is run by downstream project, but downstream project, Jam Tools controller, they are afraid sometimes, oh, my chain can impact many things. So let's run what we call the patch test. And the patch test, again, goes through all the tests that we have for a particular patch. And it's something that is not merged. You just take the Gerrit number, the rev spec, and then with that you can actually test your patch with all the system tests that we have today. That is available also in a keyboard. So if you have a Gerrit patch, you can always put test integration. I will trigger all the system tests for this patch. It's a little bit costly as well because it doesn't do any differentiation. In this case, if your project is this or that, what kind of system test I'm gonna run. In that case, it runs everything, absolutely everything that we have, but it's very useful, especially for upstream.
And how long does it take?
That one is the one that takes more because it has to go through all the tests. I mean, how the system is designed in theory is, and you will see that later, if every system test can run in parallel and it's maximum 15 minutes, so you can estimate that it shouldn't take more than 20 minutes to go through whatever test you want to do.
Yeah.
Now, the reality is different. The reality is different because, yeah, for many reasons, we cannot run everything in parallel. I don't think we have that enough gear yet. And the second reason, instability also in the cloud system makes that a test that normally should take 15 minutes because the VM doesn't come back immediately, take more time and then repeat again. It takes finally double time instead of 15, 30 minutes, I see even 40 minutes and more for a test. That shouldn't be, but it is there today. Okay? But we'll fix that. More questions? Okay. Hope I am still okay. Okay, so this probably is the one that has more questions, obviously, because it's kind of complex. Not complex, but for people that are new, probably more questions. I think we're going to be faster now. So continuous integration in general requires consistent and homogeneous development process. That means that you have different software components. You have to have a common process to put all together and to build them and to test them. That is clear. Infrastructure for fast automated code build and test of all software components, the same idea. I mean, you need to build and test fast, otherwise it's not continuous integration because the idea is to merge, I mean push and merge very often. It's very important what I said before, you need to have a very optimized test strategy because this is where you're going to spend most of your time. Build is something that even if you could influence there, it's very difficult to reduce. It's a build time, your code needs some time to build and that you cannot change. However, you can decide how much or less test you want to put and how you want to do your test. In a way that can be really optimized. And this is what we have been mostly doing this release. The next thing is control over the CI cycle from code event to test report. Some of the people, we need to have control about this full process, how it's happened, whenever there is congestion or not congestion, how long time does it take in average. So all these things, we need to have more control over that for sure. And finally, we need to have overall performance monitoring. Like say, okay, how well this CI is performing with this kind of measurement, with this kind of, strategy that we are following, because if it is not really performing, what are we doing here? Let's change the strategy or do something else, okay? So, The next one is, okay, so this is very good in papers, but what happened in OpenDaylight is that we have something like projects are very heterogeneous. As you can see here, we have platform, tools, plugin, network services, network abstraction. And you say, what does matter? Well, maybe for building, it doesn't matter much. They just build like any other. But testing-wise, it's very different requirements. You don't test the same plugin that a network service, that an abstraction. So every single thing has a different story for testing, right? Especially when we are talking about system tests. The second is projects are of different size, and that's clear. We have very big projects like controller with I don't know how many features today. I didn't count all of them, but many features. And then we have simple projects that maybe they just deploy one feature. And you can today estimate the size of a project by the number of features that they deploy. Every feature today in OpenDaylight is like a piece of functionality. So if a project deploys five features, it's a medium-sized project or something, five, six. If it is like 10 or something, it's already something big. If it is only one or two, well, it's a small project. So that kind of estimation. But this is to say that we have a Lego kind of environment here where projects are different size and very different kind of scope. And then the last thing is that the number of projects duplicates every release. And that is also something to consider. So what did we do? What did we do in Lithium release to fix all that? And this is where it comes, the optimized test strategy. This is what I call optimized test. We only test one project feature at a time, which is what we call the feature system test. Instead of getting the full project and then go and test the full thing, we just take feature by feature and then we run a system test just for that, this particular functionality. Now, because you can have this feature run alone, like independent feature, a functionality that runs all by itself, but because, again, there was a challenge there that I didn't comment, that in today in the Decaraf you can bring what, in the distribution we have today, you can bring whatever combination you need. So we need to make sure that the same feature test doesn't really fail when you load many features together. So for every single feature, we are running what we call the single test, or the only test, and the all test. Single feature and with many features. And it's exactly the same test, but to make sure that it works in the two kind of environments, okay? So the second thing with this, we only trigger system tests after code merge, what I told before, but we provide on-demand patch system test verification. So if someone in the upstream wants to verify a patch, we can run the full system test there and verify that it's not gonna break. We only run relevant system tests after code merge, which is if I'm in offset zero, for instance, I'm gonna trigger all the tests that is relevant, which is many, because this is gonna impact many projects in the downstream. However, if I'm an offset two project, if you know how we are doing the offset is independencies, it's more in the downstream, maybe I only need to run the project specific test and that's it. So depending where you are in the stream, in the stream, you're gonna run more or less tests. And it is something that you define yourself. When you define your dependencies, there is a way to say, okay, I depend on controller, in Jan tools, I depend on OpenFlow plugin, OSDB. Well, every time that this project are in the Astin, they do a change, you're gonna run your system test. It's the same a little bit of the integration job that some people know. And this is a summary. The summary that we have done this release, so the different triggers that I already talked most of them, the code submit, I can create a project verify build, and after that I can build a distribution and pass all the tests. This is on demand. The first one is on demand. I should probably add that note there for the final thing. The second is the one with the merge. The merge also creates a distribution, but now the distribution is gonna start the own project plus all the projects in the downstream tests as well. Okay, so that's important to know. And that's why you have the differentiation. Like depending when you are in the dependency change, you're gonna have more or less system tests run for a change. We have also daily and weekly releases, and this is because, for tests that are more than 15 minutes, and was in the other presentation, more than 15 minutes could be something, we just took that number, but the idea is really when we hit some number of minutes, we want to either split or just send the test to daily or weekly or something like that, because we cannot afford to have more than certain time in continuous integration. And finally, every time that there is a release creation, again, we run all the system tests that is available for all the projects. Any question? Hopefully, because I already explained this a little bit before, it's more clear. And now this is the cool thing that I wanted to talk really. This is the thing that we had done this release that maybe a few people really realize. One is the dynamic cloud infrastructure. So during Lithium release, the RLM people, some of them are sitting now with us, migrated from the fixed cloud system to dynamic rack space kind of infrastructure. By doing that, it's not only that we can scale more, because obviously a fixed system cannot scale. It's also that now we can create on demand whatever test environment, build environment as well, but especially, yeah, test environment is more needed, but build as well. Whatever environment we need, we can create on demand, and then dynamically we create it and use it, and then, yeah, reuse it later. The second thing that is super important, I think, is that now all the configuration for this VM are in SCM, which means that we can easily maintain these VMs, what kind of software they have and so on, plus their user, the user can customize that. You can file a get rid patch and then chain the software that goes in these VMs that are used for build or for tests, which is really cool. And finally, we had the advantage, like a side effect of the dynamic thing, is that before we used to clear a lot of things. When you do a test, system test especially, you clear a lot of stuff, but now because the system is, because the system automatically clean ups after the system test, you don't need to do that. It's automatically clean up for the next test. The second thing very important, we did the Jenkins Job Builder. During Lithium release, again, the RLM people, which are here, they migrated from the silos to the master Jenkins managed by Jenkins Job Builder. And this has a huge of benefits, like automatic job creation that before has to be manual, job configuration alignment. Before, projects did their own manually, very different kind of jobs, and now they are all aligned together. Inter-project trigger, super important. From one project, I want to trigger another project before we silo, it's not possible. JJB templates in SCM, that is another benefit. Anybody can write any Jenkins job that they want, just need to file a patch and that's it. And finally, we had the sandbox, which is really awesome. Tang is here, prepare the sandbox, that you can really debug any job today, but also any system test that you prepare, you can debug in the sandbox and make sure that it works before you put that in production. So really cool. Finally, this is what we have done in integration. This was RLM work most of the time, like Andrew and Tan. So integration, on the other hand, what we have done this release is more to create templates for projects to use and do system tests. A lot of them with this release. Some example for single and three-node instant cluster tests. We create get rid triggers and also periodic triggers. So depending what you want, you can choose the template. You have system test code verification kind of template. And also we create a reference suite so for people to look and reuse. And those one are for functional system tests, for performance, as well as for scalability. And this is really useful. So people just, we did for OpenFlow, but people can reuse this in another project, just changing a few things. Basic longevity as well. What is NES? And this is my last one. Yeah, sorry.
What do you mean by longevity?
Longevity is a long time test. A test that runs for a day or more. Yeah, we have templates for that too. Yes. We were missing that in this release, but lately we got it in place. I mean, at least in the sandbox it's running. And finally, what is doing in Beryllium? So Beryllium, we have some ideas already. Dynamic cloud infra, the first we need to do in Beryllium is to fix the stability issues that we have, because that is probably hitting the performance that we should be having, but we don't have today. So what we are looking is at RLM people especially, looking at changing the cloud API protocol for the node pool. I think that's the idea, so that we can get a more stable system. The second is the Jenkins pipeline management. So I mentioned already that we don't have visibility from Austin to Austin. So we are thinking that we need a tool like the Sul that they use in OpenStack. With that, we can manage the pipeline from merge to system test in a very precise way. Third one is the performance monitoring. Exactly the Sul, apparently they have a dashboard as well that you can check things like Jenkins queues, CI cycles, and all these kind of things. We are looking for that already on this release. Hopefully we can do it. And finally, we are working in integration. This is all kind of RLM builder. We are working in integration to get more of these templates and robot suites as a reference. So that is also the thing that we are doing today. My last one is the most important thing we need to continue doing here is this collaboration between a RLM builder and integration group. Because from there is where we can really get a performance state-of-the-art continuous integration. That's it. Any question? I don't know, probably they are waiting, but if anybody has any question, I think we still have some, yeah, 1 minute or something, or a couple of minutes. Yeah, ahead.
So currently, when the new setup, you start feature tests for downstream projects, but that doesn't involve rebuilding the...
These ones.
Yeah. You don't rebuild the downstream projects at all, do you?
No. So...
would it be interesting to do that? Because there was an incident last week where there was a change in Neutron Northbound, the local VSDB, but we only found out...
So that is the integration build, sorry.
Yeah.
So you see, every time there is a verify, it's very less than happen. It's only it's only the project verify build, and then the step to go distribution, it's not clear here, but the step that goes from verify build to distribution build is optional. That's why you need to trigger on demand. However, in the second, when you do a merge, you trigger two things when you do a merge. When you do a merge, you have your own distribution, I mean, a new distribution created in the system that you're going to pass a lot of system tests. But at the same time down, you're going to create an integration build. We call that integration build. All the projects that are in the downstream, they're going to build the code for exactly the reason that you said now. Because it could be that you change in your merge, break the build in some of the projects. So this is our idea always. When you do a merge into a project, you can build, you can break two things. One is you break some dependency or something in the build already, JUnit or something of that particular test in the downstream. Or you can just break some system test that was working before. That's why we are always interested to trigger as much as tests as possible when we do merge. And again, we would like to do this at verify, but it's too costly. I mean, we have thought about that, but it's too costly. Yeah. I mean, if you are a company or someone is consuming OpenDelight and you have a small set of feature, you could do in verify. You can afford it. You can afford it. But if you have a huge project, Open Daylight, doing in verify, that doesn't really mean too much. Yes?
Is it possible to get a higher CPU memory for sandbox?
Okay. So any other question? Because
yeah.
I think, yeah, go ahead.
So what guidelines or steps are we taking? So that any new features that we develop in cyber, like we have an equivalent integration test. So what are the things to do developers that have the function of the
platform? So this is a very good question. So, and I think I went through this somewhere. If not, I can ask you. So, in all this process of, in all this change, today, the project had the responsibility to build enough, unit tests, not only developing tests. So when you build code, you run all these unit tests. And second, all that we said about system tests that you need to write today, it's also project responsibility. We are helping projects, and there was a PowerPoint, we are helping projects with the templates, with giving example of how to write the robot test, the system test. But as of today, because that doesn't scale, in the beginning of the times, in hydrogen, a little bit in helium, the integration group was writing system tests for projects. fewer of them because we are limited resources. But at some point, we said, it doesn't escape. I mean, a group here cannot buy system test for everybody. So in the end, we said, yeah, now it's project responsibility. And the only thing we're going to be doing is providing all the tooling, all the things, the help, the troubleshooting, whatever the people need, the support to write their own system test. And that's the strategy today. So.
And you made it a requirement for the deliverable.
Yes. Yes, that's true.
Nobody is verifying that you're fully covered
yet. Yes. There is a requirement for all projects going to simultaneous release that they have a basic system test. We haven't really defined that very much. Basic system test, right? Now, if your feature is going to be stable, and this is something that we're going to be doing this release, it's not just enough a basic system test. You need to show performance tests, scalability tests, longevity tests, like your feature is stable for a while. All these kind of things are requirements today if you want to get the stable label for your feature. And this is another thing that happens. When you grow, it's very difficult to know, especially for user, what kind of parts are stable or not stable. So we want to do this work already in the OpenDLI to differentiate these features. Anything else? Okay, well, thank you very much.